I'm your host, of course, Mary Davis, and we have a great show for you this evening and a great lineup. Some of these people you've seen before, two you've never seen with me on TV or heard on radio. But we're going to talk about a lot of things, and I'm going to give you an idea of what we're going to talk about. And then I'm going to let each of these people here, especially our candidates, reintroduce themselves and explain to you why they deserve your vote. Now, in case you haven't noticed, there is a presidential primary campaign going on. The issues are many. Super PACs, campaign financing, pledge super delegates, outrageous things, college tuition cost, immigration, voting rights, women's rights, candidates running away from their voting records, bait and switch tactics, name calling, i.e. lying Ted and crooked Hillary. College level education is a front burner issue, but elementary education is rarely, if ever, mentioned. And if not, and if it were not for Bernie Sanders championing no tuition for public colleges, education may not have been mentioned at all. Republicans want public education left entirely up to the states. When the states held sway over education in the not too distant past, we know where that went. Brown versus the Board of Education comes to mind. Here in Buffalo, public schools are in a life and death struggle. The majority on the board under the sway of Carl Palladino would like nothing more than to do away with public education altogether and replace it with private ownership of charter schools. The board majority, however, does have its problems. James M. Sampson, board president and powerful majority member, did not have 500 valid signatures and is ineligible to remain on the ballot. He is rumored to be planning a write-in campaign, though. His challenger is Jennifer McCousey, and she is here with us tonight. Patricia Elliott, East District candidate, backed by Palladino, also did not make the ballot. 18-year-old high school senior Austin Harrick, I think that's where you pronounce his name, who is challenging Palladino in the Park District, made the ballot with only 9 signatures to spare. Colleen Russell, East District, is another Palladino candidate, is due in court to answer fraud charges, did make the ballot by 6 signatures. And Byron McIntyre, Central District, and I was understanding that he was not challenged, so I won't say he survived challenges to his petitions, since I understand he really wasn't challenged at all. He is reported to be sympathetic to the Palladino wing of the majority part of the board. Palladino has made it perfectly clear that the 4 black women currently serving on the board is intolerable. And to me, I say, well, too bad, Carl. Better get used to it. And now to talk and have our guests reintroduce themselves. 2 of them you already know because they are frequent guests and they are very popular on the show and popular in the community. So we'll start out with those who you haven't met before and let them introduce themselves. First of all, there's Paulette Woods. And Paulette, you're a candidate. And let's hear from you and tell our listeners and people viewing you just who are you and what you're running for and why they need to vote for you.
Hi, I'm Paulette Woods, and I'm a candidate for the Central District in Buffalo, for the Buffalo Board of Education. I'm a homeowner. I've been a resident of the Central District for 26 years. I have 32 years of experience working as a senior budget examiner for Erie County Department of Probation. I have worked with the county exec and other administrators to help manage Erie County's $1.5 billion budget. I love children, and I have worked for the Erie County Department of Youth Services for 13 years. That department runs all of the youth development and delinquency prevention programs for all of Erie County's youth. I have a long history of working with community leaders and pastors such as Apostle Robert Saunders and his Refuge Temple Citadel of Hope. That's a non-secure foster home for troubled youth. I've been working to break the school to prison pipeline for many years. I currently work with the Erie County Department of Probation. We supervise over 3,400 juveniles who, but for us and our help, would be in jail. Our children deserve better from our schools. I want to stop the dropout rate, reduce the dropout rate. 3 out of 4 of our young African American and Hispanic youth don't graduate. That's a travesty. Any child that goes through 12 years of school should be able to come out with a job, a career, a skill, be employable, and be a productive citizen. I am here running for the school board because I want our future to be putting children first and prepare our children for this society to be productive. My issues are reduce the dropout rate, reduce suspensions for our kids, use the restorative justice method of restoring our kids rather than kicking them out, establish new high schools, because every child doesn't want to go to or shouldn't have to go to 4 years of college. There are many 1 and 2 year career and trades that our children can come out and get a job and be productive. I want a better bargain for our youth and for our parents. That's why I'm running.
Thank you, Paulette, for that. And now we go to Jennifer Mikuzi. Okay, that's want to get it right.
Much better than normal.
And she is also running, and we're introducing her to the larger public tonight. So tell us about you and why you're running. Just who are you?
My name is Jen Mikuzi. I am running for the West District of the Buffalo School Board. I am born and raised pretty much my whole life on the west side of Buffalo. I'm a mom. I have 3 children currently in the Buffalo Public School System. And I think that what I'm representing is a community voice. So my work with Push Buffalo has been around community organizing. My job was to go out, and still is to go out, and communicate with folks around issues that they're facing in our community, and how do we bring them to the table, bring voices to the table, and try and change the current situation for our city. And Push concentrates a lot on housing, but what I was recognizing was the issues around education, especially in, you know, the West District, where there's a really diverse population. There are no real resources, and there for the teachers or the students, and there's no real communication that's happening throughout the schools in order for the parents or the caregivers or even the services that help offer these the immigrant and refugee population the communication they need for their child to be able to succeed in Buffalo. And I, you know, that's number one, my primary issue is to bring communication to the communities. I will say, and I say it confidently, that, you know, I represent a large portion of this city. You know, a single mother who has been raising her children and relies on the communication of the schools in order for me to be able to understand what's happening in my child's schools. And the example which really brought me to the table is working in my Push capacity, we were bringing folks to the table to come to these Board of Education meetings to start realizing that there's things happening that, you know, folks aren't aware of. And as we were bringing folks in by the hundreds, and I'm helping to organize this with Citizen Action, I started realizing that my own children's schools, both Waterfront and Middle College, where my daughters attend and my kindergartner attends Waterfront, were in turmoil. There was stuff going on in their school that I had no idea. And as a parent and a community advocate and a leader in the community, I should have known that. So now it's personal. Now it's about my children, it's about the children in my community, it's about the children in the city of Buffalo. And you know, for me, I think that it's a next step. It's definitely a next step. If I can, without, you know, college education, without a pocket full of money, without the power that seems to have the, you know, the good old boys club that's running around Buffalo right now, without having that behind me, people should realize that they still can stand up and fight and do what's right for their community. The issues that I really want to concentrate on are definitely communication, you know, and just transparency. Well, what's happening? We hear that there's money, we hear these trickle-down things, we see that folks are out to basically get us because we don't have the power to stop money and power. We watch other schools that don't have to follow Buffalo Public School rules end up taking all the resources that our children really need, and we're investing in beautifying all these schools, but we haven't looked into the inside of the schools. We have not done inside out, and doing it outside in is completely backwards, and I want to know why. Community wants to know why. So there's that. I really feel whether, and I will say this, and not really, I'm known for not caring how it comes out, so here we go. I had the two parts of the Buffalo Public Schools that really count are the teachers and the students. That's how it works, right? If you don't give the teachers everything they need in order for my child to be able to succeed, that doesn't label me aligned with the teachers. That labels me a parent who cares about who's teaching my children. I would love to see, we need to have more resources available to teachers, teachers' aides. We need to be able to have smaller classrooms so teachers don't come in with the morale of 40 students to a class and not doing the job they set out to do, but still come in every day knowing what they're dealing with. That's unfair. And this teaching as opposed, you know, teaching and then to testing, that the testing is not concentrating on the creativity, the genius, and the capacity that a child brings to the table. Filling in a bubble does not tell you what type of artistic abilities that child has. That teacher can bring that out of them, and if you start evaluating teachers according to a bubble, you start evaluating kids according to a bubble, then the schools are not going to succeed just like they aren't now, and we need to bring back some real, you know, testing, or some real, if you're going to test with a bubble, you need to test the creativity of a child too. If we have that equal platform, then it makes sense. If we don't, we're missing out, and our kids are going to suffer. So.
You laid out a lot for us. These are two candidates that you have not met on the Mary Davis Show. And we have a third candidate who has been around for a while and run different campaigns, but we'll let her reintroduce herself again since we're talking about candidates tonight.
Well, thank you, Mary. As a frequent guest on the show, I feel like home. My name is Betty
pajamas?
Jane Grant. They're in my bag over there. I am the second district legislator for Erie County. A former school board member, I served the Ferry District that's now being served by Sharon Belton Cotman. I was in that position for 4 years, so I got a lot of knowledge, experience about the school board of education, those individuals who are qualified for it, and those who might not be. And I want to say, as the campaign manager for Paulette Woods, who's running for the Central District, she is uniquely qualified. Known as she has 32 years of experience working for Erie County as the senior finance budget examiner, she also worked in the Department of Youth, mentoring those individuals who came in who might need additional mentoring and discipline. Paulette also is a community activist. She's a member of We Are Women Warriors, and we conduct a lot of programs, a lot of seminars, working around youth. And how we got started was when they boycotted the Buffalo Public Schools, when it was called several years ago. And I felt that a boycott of school was not in the best interest of those children. They lost one day of school. A better measure would have been to have the parents come in to take over those schools for a day, to be there so that our children would not lose a day of education. I approached Paulette, and she expressed interest in running because she has raised and tutored and mentored her younger sister and brother. So she has the experience of being a teacher, of being a surrogate parent, of being a role model. And she has a deep knowledge of the resources, how it should be spent, how it should be better spent. So I'm just extremely glad we chose a candidate that, number one, knows the issue, number one, has mentored, tutored, and has been surrogate parents for her younger brothers and sisters, has been a surrogate parent and mentor for those children who come to family court. And she has also has been an advocate in her church community. She's an ordained minister at Greater Word Fellowship Church. So now does she has that pastoral experience and background where she can help in the church environment. She also has community experience where she can help in the community. And by her being so involved with youth, I know that she's going to be a terrific board member. And someone said you have to have children to be a good boy education member. I disagree. You have to be a good individual. You have to be knowledgeable. You have to be sympathetic. You have to be able to be that independent voice sometime to say this is the way that should be done. So having children is a plus, but it's not a requirement. You know, when I became a board member, my youngest one was 40 years old. So I was a grandparent. I have grandchildren in Buffalo Public School. They go to Montessori School, and I'm still gifted and talented. So I'm a big proponent of public education. I know that the board has some problems because you have a split. No board can act effectively for the children and parents and the student and the teachers with that split. So hopefully with this election this year, we have a board that's united, that's going to speak in one voice, one same cohesive voice, not one faction trying to overdo another faction. This has been happening for the past 3 years. I think with the election of Jennifer McCosey in the West District, Paulette Woods for the Central District, Austin Herrick for the Park District, Jay Hope for the North District, and Sharon Bell Comet for the Ferry District, and I'm missing one district, I forget which one I'm missing. But
East,
I think
East.
With Park, yeah. Park is Austin Herrick, and of course, Dr. Harris Tiggs for the East District. If we get these individuals elected, we will have, I guarantee you, a more cohesive, better working, better functioning board that's going to help Superintendent Cash, going to help him to run the Buffalo Public Schools in a more positive and effective manner.
And you missed one thing about yourself. You had a very, very, very great fundraiser just the other night that I attended.
Yes, I did.
Betty Jean Grant is also founder of Buffalo Hoops.
Buff City Hoops, I'm the founder, because as you know, 2 years ago, we had the Gus Macker coming out of Buffalo. And we needed to have a place where youth can go in the summertime to play basketball. We happened to go into Grand Island, crossing the bridge, paying the tolls and everything else. So I said, well, why not just keep the basketball in Buffalo? Let's form our own league. And I talked to Mary Holman, who's our president, and we decided last year to hold the first tournament, and we had 500 children, Mary. 500 individual children coming from all parts of Buffalo and outside of Buffalo, playing in Massey Park from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m., not one fight broke out. Not one fight. He was able to work with Bach International, and he got tablets. We had 25 tablets given away, so it was a great affair. And I was glad to see the councilman of Grand Island there with a table of 10 last night. Glad to see that we had a diversity, because it's going to take a diverse community to ensure that we have a good community. And so with the school board, we're going to make sure that when we have programs in the community, that school board members know about it, that they're involved with it. Paulette was there because she's involved with the community. And we have school board members who are involved with the community, who are involved with the student, where he lives and where he goes to church and where he goes to play. Then you have, they take that knowledge back into that board meeting, and they can empathize more for that child than someone who maybe come from outside and have no children involved at all, or maybe don't have a feeling. Buffalo is a minority slash majority population of children. It means the children of color from all these different ethnic groups and the immigrants make up the bulk of the Buffalo Public Schools. And so you have to have their needs addressed. And sometimes you have to have people from that community speaking for them. And if you have parents on the school board, you have people who are involved with the community, I think it's a good mix for everybody.
Well, Frank, it looks like our claim to fame in this is that we are both part of the Buffalo Public School System.
Oh, yeah.
So, Frank, let's hear from you. I went to Buffalo Public Schools.
Yeah. That's about it. My children went to Buffalo Public Schools. I'm Frank Gissom, columnist with the Buffalo Criterion News. And I have no idea why I'm on this panel, but I'm here for window dressing, and I'm going to let the school board candidates answer all your questions.
Wait, me a voter, too, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm a voter too, yeah, and I vote regularly. I haven't missed a vote
since
I've been able to vote, I don't think of it.
Oh, great.
And I was a former school board candidate back in 1994. I ran up for the school board. Fifth out of three seats we were up. I think I came in fifth out of like 15 candidates.
Oh, wow. Well, that's a good showing.
You can say that again, God.
Yeah.
Wow.
Probably was a blessing I lost, but yeah.
Yeah, that's a good thing. You don't want to say that.
All the aggravation they go through and at no pay, I'm sure it was. You know, I don't know.
I don't
have the patience of Job.
But you're doing it for the children. You know, I know that stipend they give you doesn't cover your transportation. But when you go there and you find out that they got a $1 billion budget, when you're there and you're saying, well, this is best for the children, this is best for the community, there's a sense of achievement, a sense of accomplishment. And that's why people do it for free, because they are so in tune with what is needed in our community. They all want children to be able to graduate with a degree, and with an education, they can go get a job. And so sometimes that's lost. It's lost between you know, people talk about the unions, talk about this and other things that has no difference. The most important component, I think, in Buffalo Public Schools are the students, the parents, and the teachers. Those are the three components. If one is not addressed, you don't have a good working board. So when you have parents who know they come into that school system and they feel welcome, if you have teachers there who know they can teach what they learn and still try and teach to a book or a test, you have students who want to go there, and while they're there, they know that they're in a safe environment, in a learning environment, creative environment, where they can use their skills. We all are not book learners, some are tactile learners. Kids learn different ways. When you teach a certain way, sometimes the creativity of that child is repressed, and so you need to have school board members and teachers, and my teacher myself, that's my other job. I'm a certified special education teacher, so I know about teaching, I know about being a parent, and I also know about being on the school board. So when you have children wanting to go to school, teachers glad to be there and want to teach them, and parents feeling comfortable in that school, you got a perfect mix.
Now, I do. I have a problem with a school board member who's going to come on the board is going to kowtow to the teachers union. I mean, I do have a problem with that. So, I mean, I'd be interested to know what the candidates feel about that, because I think it's useless if you're just there because the teachers union puts you there and wants you to do their bidding and make more money. Because that's essentially, in my point of view, and I had children that went through public schools, that this teachers union is there to see how much more money they could extract from themselves, which is fine.
Is that a fair statement?
I think it's a fair statement. I'm just, you know.
Okay, let me tell you this. When Mary Rick Capsack said she was not going to run for re-election, that created a vacancy. Eva Doyle was asked to run, and I supported that because I thought she had been a fantastic candidate. Mm-hmm. For whatever reason, Ms. Eva Doyle decided, for personal reasons, she was not ready to run at this time. I called Paulette Woods, and I told her there's a vacancy on the board. Ms. Doyle was not going to be running, because she and I both were going to support Mrs. Doyle. I asked Ms. Paulette Woods to run. So no union people contact me, contact Paulette to run. She ran because she feels that she'd be the best a candidate for that particular seat at this particular time. So you said union endorsement. I don't know why these subjects even came up. Mm-hmm. There's been no endorsement.
I can't understand how we have all this anti-union, teacher union. What bothers me is there was a time, and I'm sure probably everybody around this table can remember that, when being a teacher was something that was respectful. Now, I know that they're not, every teacher's not a great teacher. Mm-hmm. Some are pretty awful, and some do teach just because they want the money or whatever else. And I've had people even mention that to me, that there's some that are there just for that. But there was a time when teachers were respected, and like most union people were respected. Mm-hmm. I've never seen such venom that goes out against teachers now. It's like teachers are the scum of the earth. Oh, so you listen
nobody's
to some of the rhetoric.
Nobody said that, Frank.
But a lot of people come out with that, and especially when I listen to some of the statements that come out from the majority members on the board, not all of them, but quite a few of them. And if you listen to them, you would think that teachers were the devil.
Well, how much of the budget goes to actual teacher salary? How much actually goes to teacher salary?
But not just teacher salary. You got those for retired teachers. I think about 75% of the budget. I could be wrong, but I know it's 50% goes towards those benefits for teachers. You know, a lot of teachers retired. That has to be paid from the current budget. So mm-hmm. I would say if you look at the teachers, the medical of the current teachers, retired teachers, the pension of retired teachers, and the salary of the teachers, that's a big part of that budget.
So my point is the most important thing that the whole school board is paying teachers is not really education. It's really the salary.
If there weren't teachers, who would educate the kids
I'm just saying, Frank?
If there weren't teachers, who would teach? Who would teach them read and write or whatever else?
And they can't teach for free. They have to be paid. And don't forget, there's contracts. The teacher union now has operating a contract that has not been, it's over 10 years, that has not been negotiated. They're working on the current negotiator was done 10 years ago. So you can't blame teacher for wanting what was negotiated and given to them 10 years ago.
Wait a minute, can I say something about teachers?
Yes. Absolutely.
Look, I have a balanced point of view on teachers. Now, I have 22 nieces and nephews who went through the Buffalo Public School System, and they've gone on, and I was able to help them to go on to get undergraduate degrees and graduate degrees. But I've had dedicated teachers who helped the students, mm-hmm. and I've had to go down to that school several times, and with a teacher who told my nephew, any dummy can pass my class, all he has to do is copy off the board. And my nephew wanted to do research projects and work on current events, and he didn't, that type of teaching did not challenge him. And I had to go down to the school because they were going to suspend my nephew because he asked to do more. Now, I've been fighting with teachers who don't want to do their jobs to make sure that they didn't hurt my nephews and nieces and they got a good education. But I strongly feel that the teachers need development, teacher development courses, because they need to be able to get new and innovative methods to reach our urban youth. I feel the teachers need diversity training because we have children who are from many languages, skills, and African Americans who they need to know how to respect. My problem is the suspension rate. Every time a child is suspended, he's three times more likely to drop out in the 10th grade.
Right.
I want the schools to be a center for learning where our children feel welcome and the teachers do their job. Now, I do believe they deserve to get paid for their job, but I also have this problem with, I'm a civil servant and we have to pay something toward our fringe benefits. Mm-hmm. I believe in fair and reasonable contracts, and I would like to save something on all these fringe benefit costs so we can reduce class sizes and we can put expanded preschool to third grade math and reading. Our children need to get that foundation in reading and math by the third grade or they will not be successful. That is important. That is the foundation for their learning. Putting children first is not a slogan to me. I'm talking about, I have great nieces and nephews in these schools. I want these children to come out with an education. If that means helping the teachers by letting them go down to take courses at the teacher's center, then so be it.
Right.
The teachers have to be able to do their jobs, but the teachers are not an enemy. I know a lot of teachers who are buying the supplies for our children, who are loving and nurturing our children. So let's take a balanced approach to looking at these teachers.
What about you,
Jen?
Only,
I've been boiling over waiting to talk about this. The reason that I came out so strong is just because I had said in the very first statement that I had made publicly is that there are teachers who have really helped my children, and my children are better for it. It immediately started taking this what you're talking about too, where I want to get on the board to find out what is the deal. Do I know exactly what's in a teacher contract? No, but I do know it's a statistic. We don't have enough resources for teachers or students. So if we're gonna start holding teachers accountable, why are we holding just them accountable when there's administration above them, there's money that comes in above them? Why aren't we holding those standards accountable? Why aren't the contracts focusing on exactly what you're talking about? I am not against diversity training. I am now the training and logistics coordinator with Push Buffalo. I look into and develop trainings in order to keep up with what's going on in current. Diversity training is 100% necessary, no matter where you are in the city of Buffalo, no matter what you do, if you're working with communities in any capacity, right? And do I agree with some of the things that you trickle down that comes into teacher contracts? I don't know all that. That's why I want this position. I will not sit here and profess to say I think all teachers are greater. No, I think that the systems that are in place right now aren't working for the teachers, they're not working for the students,
right.
And if you don't have those two capacities working, there's someone else who's accountable. And it's the folks that will be sitting on this board that make the decisions for the teachers, for the students. It's the folks that bring the money in on the federal level. How much millions of dollars is Buffalo owed right now that didn't get it? We got it, then they took it, now we're gonna get. No, these are all rumors that I'm hearing. I know they're true to a point. I've sat through trainings, I can't remember everything, but I'm gonna sit on this board when I get elected on this board, because it's too much determination. But I'm gonna sit on this board and I'm gonna find out how to take all this negativity and all this political and all this garbage to me, and I'm gonna make this where teachers are respected again. And also, if teachers are not following the criteria that needs to be put in place, why aren't the teachers who aren't doing what they're supposed to be doing held accountable? Because the systems are messed up. Why aren't we looking at the systems instead of directly pointing at a teacher who's looking at your child and trying to give them a better education?
What's your opinion on charter schools?
My opinion on charter schools is teachers and students, no matter where they, no matter where they go to school, they're still teachers and students in the school system, right? The charter schools, to me, are a result of the Buffalo failing schools. The charter schools, to me, were a shiny new penny that was brought to community saying that, oh, well, the Buffalo schools are failing, so you can go here. The charter schools, statistically, and they are facts, they do not have to follow the same criteria that Buffalo Public Schools has to. They exist under mostly private ownership. Their rules are different. Why is that? If a parent like myself, who may have a little bit more insight and have been around and have talked to people, if I didn't know that a certain charter school or charter schools in the area were doing this and didn't have to follow criteria, and if my child had any issues and happened to be not what they were looking for once they accepted them, and they can kick them back wherever they feel like it, to me, that's not cool. That's not cool. It's not fair. If it isn't equity in Buffalo, New York, ain't nothing equal the way it's supposed to be. If we can't start at on the school level, you got to be kidding me. And now that I have some insight, the charter schools, I'm not saying shut all the charter schools down. I'm saying invest in the Buffalo Public Schools before you go and offer something to a person who may not understand, be like, oh, well, Buffalo schools,
what about you, Paula?
Stink.
Well, I believe that we don't need a two-tiered school system where the charter schools and the criterion schools are excellent and the rest of Buffalo, 80% minorities, are condemned to struggling, failing schools. But I do believe that we need innovative high schools, and there are cases where we need charter schools where we can teach a child a trade, welding or carpentry, or skills that to fill the medical corridor jobs. We do need, and I am for, some innovative charter schools, like one of our pastors was proposing a science and technology charter school. But I do not want a two-tiered system where we have all these struggling schools and the majority of the schools are failing. I believe we should focus on public education, making it better, and putting our resources there. And my particular focus is going to be on ensuring that the money that is allocated to our children is spent in the best interest of our children. I have a bachelor's degree in accounting and a master's in public administration, and I'm looking at some of the ways the services are provided. Each of the schools has a garbage pickup contract. Why aren't they bid collectively in a volume and saving money? Each of the schools has a maintenance budget, and if the maintenance supervisor doesn't spend the money on the schools, when we're asking them to open the schools, have after school programs, make that school a center for our community, if they save money rather than opening the schools, that they get the pocket. That's not accountability. I want to redirect these resources to the children.
A lot of the talk that comes out from the majority on the school board isn't, and it's kind of like common knowledge, is that they're in favor of charter schools primarily because they would be private money makers for some of these people. They're interested in private ownership of these charter schools, and I don't agree with that at all. I think it's a public obligation that a country educates its population.
Let me tell you this too, and you have members on the Board of Education who have buildings who are being rented to charter schools.
Yes, I think that's conflict of interest.
That's a definite conflict of interest. As you sit there and support public education and traditional schools, you are renting and buying buildings to have charter schools. Now me, 10 years ago, I was totally pro public education, traditional and anti-charter schools. I found out that when the Buffalo Board of Education open charter schools, and Buffalo Board of Public Education do have charter schools. Enterprise Charter School is run by the Buffalo Board of Education, and so is Westminster Charter Schools. So but the Buffalo Board of Education already is in the charter school business. I like to see those parents who want their children to enroll in a charter school have that right. They have that right, and that should be acknowledged. But however, I don't think they should exist at the mercy of the Buffalo Public Schools. There should be separate funding sources. You shouldn't have a charter school taking the money out of the pool and set aside for public schools. Albany should fix it. Have separate stream of money for both charter schools and both public schools. If any parents who want their child in public school, they have that right, and we have the obligation to ensure their rights are being met. But at the same token, we shouldn't have board members who say, you know what, to hell with the public education as it's been for the last 200 years, we want all charter schools. When you talk about charter schools, then you start talking about private schools. Are we going to be funding private school with public money? And then you talk about religious school. So that opening has already been there. Those charter schools that's already in Buffalo, we have had 12 when I was a school board member. I'm not sure how many we have today. I think it's probably 16, 17. And some of them are good. But those who have not been good have closed. That's because they were able to send those children back who didn't succeed. When you are in a charter school, you don't have to educate everybody. If a child comes there with some learning disabilities and these special programs.
Or a problem kid.
Mm-hmm. They can say, okay, oh no, you don't fit here. That child winds up back in public education.
Right.
So they are really taking the cream of the crop. And those children who might not may need additional services, they're sending them back to public education. So what if public education wasn't there? Where would these kids land if all school was charter school and was selective?
Well, is there any statistics? We've had charter schools long enough to compile some statistics on the educational outcomes of charter schools as opposed to public schools?
It is no better and sometimes worse than public education. Mm-hmm. That I know. That's statistics. It's no better than
that's
public education.
That's what I've heard, too. I don't have numbers, but that's what I've heard, too.
Well, I read numbers. It's no better than public education as we know it in traditional school, and sometimes they're worse. We had Stepping Stones Charter School to close. Mm-hmm. We had one in Central Park Plaza to close. I forgot the name of that school, but it's like high school children. So those charter schools that serve underprivileged children who have been denied a quality education mm-hmm. to start, those charter schools that don't do so
why,
well.
Why do they tend to close? Because they're not bringing enough revenue streams?
Because those charter schools did not pick the cream of the crop. Those charter schools like King Urban Center, which is under review. Those like Stepping Stone Academy that was closed. The one that was in Central Park Plaza. They was teaching all children. And unfortunately for them, most of the children who came there had additional needs and it was not being addressed. And so therefore those schools closed. When they're in South Buffalo to get all the money, the resources, and you have board members who support those charter schools privately with individual money, those schools tend to do better. It's not
that
the
even
teachers,
possible,
it's not that mm-hmm. charter school teachers are better, it's that they're being provided more resource to be better teachers, and those children are coming from private households that put more of a premium on a quality education.
You know, people forget that the first charter school before there was charter schools was Build Academy.
Yes.
And it was a big controversy then and about it, but it was implemented, but positions have changed since then.
I would wonder, basically, how our canvas for the school board, I know that Betty Jean has maneuvered many pitfalls for traveling, but you're going to be up against a lot of not only some hostility on the board itself, but there's a lot of people that are not on the board that support these. I'm often wondering, how do you plan to navigate some of these?
Carl Palladino, just say it.
Yeah. Well, that's true, because he's the biggest one there, basically.
That's all you have to navigate, because they follow along whatever he does. So mm-hmm. they're weak.
I mean, I really feel like we need to look into the schools, the Buffalo Public Schools and the high schools that do have the vocational training that you're talking about. McKinley, for example, they do construction, they do horticulture. Emerson is a culinary institute. You know, MST is science and technology. Like, we do have Buffalo Public Schools with all of these vocational training pieces that people are looking for, and they're not being uplifted, you know, in a way that they should be, because there's no funding and resources for it. We have charter schools with science in the name of it. So then other folks are you know, oh, well, they're geared toward science, so I'm going to send my child there. But if your child, as again, we can say it over and over again, but I think we should, because it's going to prove that point. If they do not meet the standards of the school's criteria, which sometimes parents don't know until the kids are in the school. Yeah, we'll welcome your child, but the second that the child is not performing up to their standards, because they have to hit their graduation rate. If they don't hit their graduation rate, they don't get the funds that they need to exist. Mm-hmm. And then that's when, and I'm telling you this from a community standpoint, this is a trickle down, this is what I get from community and what I know, I don't have the stats, is that's when folks, you know, and he who shall not be named,
but
are putting in their own
to
money
to the
it.
Board when you've got to navigate, and again, as Frank pointed out, you got the Palladinos on that board. So you're going to have to navigate a lot of these.
You
times.
Have to bring
what
a voice.
What type of skills are you going to bring to help you go through that minefield? And there is a minefield on the board. There is one
you
there.
You can't, to me, and I think and this is going to get back to the whole, you know, why I'm on this board. I was also not asked to get on this board by any union whatsoever. Mm-hmm. I myself, when I found out, and Sharon Cotman can tell you, when I found out that my children's schools were in jeopardy and I had to speak out as a parent, I was at every board meeting. I spoke out as Jennifer, and I was asked repeatedly by community, because I was representing community as well, you should think about it. You should figure this out. I sought out to see what this was all about. I'm the one who asked the questions. Because I care that my child's pre-K teacher was able to identify some learning issues that my own son had that I couldn't see, because my kid is perfect, you can't tell me anything. The Buffalo Public Schools have resources. They have occupational therapy, physical therapy. They have folks that come into the classroom that work with your child. My child is going through that right now, is gonna benefit and be just where he's supposed to be in first grade because of a teacher. It isn't because I wanted teachers to work with me. It's because of the teachers that my daughter is vying for first in her class as a junior, top athlete, all high. My daughter graduated middle college, fourth in her class, all high. These are because of this, the coaches, the teachers, that these teachers have done so much for my children. My teachers, I went to school 77 in Buffalo, New York, and Mr. Newhouse and Mrs. Long and Mr. Romeo, these were my teachers. I'm 45 and I can remember them better than I can remember what I ate last week. Mm-hmm. Teachers make a difference. Does that align me with the block? No. Do I get upset when I'm put and being called a union goon, like in print? That upsets me, because if you can't see that
is
a teacher
is coming out from board members, because what you say, you go to board meeting, you know, you're
yeah.
there, and I'm just wondering, both you and Paulette, and what my question is, you're going to be walking into a situation that may take some skills in order to go through, because as Sharon Beltman Cotman has often told, it can be like a minefield.
But can I say, mm-hmm. interject mm-hmm. here? The children are the future of our community. They are our future. All of the community has a vested interest in these children succeeding. I am not walking in there alone. I'm mm-hmm. a community activist. I am representing my church.
That's
pastors supporting me. I have my block club supporting me. I have the children in my community mm-hmm. saying, why aren't they teaching us life skills? How come I don't know how to manage my credit? I have the parents who, concerned parents who care about their children's future. Mm-hmm. I'm not walking in there alone. I'm walking in there representing 33,000 children who demand, deserve an education,
right.
and their parents mm-hmm. and their family. And I am independent. No one has given me a dime, and I'm tired of listening about this power and that mm-hmm. power. Well, let's mm-hmm. talk about people power,
mm-hmm.
churches,
parent power.
Communities,
mm-hmm.
parents. Let's talk about our future, which is I want my community to succeed, and we can't succeed if the children don't succeed.
Who is your opponent?
Byron McIntyre.
And I think he is also supportedly, both overtly or covertly, by Mr. Palladino. And I keep getting back to this point. The two of you are going to have to sit on that board with a person who is extremely hostile to what you
disrespectful,
want.
And disrespectful. Don't think you should be there.
Be there in the first
you
place.
Wouldn't want to be, don't understand why you yeah, should even be in the
be
room
there,
with him.
You know, and all these different kinds of things. And it's going to take, I would imagine, some skills. And I think the both of you certainly have plenty of skills. I think you do. But it's something that, have you thought about what you're going to have to face?
I have. I mean, I have. And what's funny is, who and what I've become working in organizing, working with community, working across, you know, crossing over Main Street and actually trying to bring the city together on a citywide aspect on so many levels. You just, the skills that you need is to be able to talk to people and mm-hmm. just identify and meet people where they're at. I don't know anything more than the next person. I learn from everybody, no matter where they come from or how old they are. And that's what I think, you know, when you take this group that we seem to have formed here, and you put us together, you have so many perspectives, and you have nothing but the people behind us, right? So Austin is bringing the youth, and I'm bringing community on a diverse level, and you're bringing community, and then more of the, you're like the church folks. And I mean, there is the church community on the east side is definitely different from what's on the west side. So how do we learn from each other? What
well,
things do we bring
current
together?
Member, the four African-American women who are on the board right now, and so on, all of them have any color in the hair at all. It should be all gray with streaks, mm-hmm. but what they've had to go through on that board.
And right, you and they need help.
Who was your opponent?
James Sampson.
James. Oh, so you might not even have an opponent.
Mm-hmm. He's a write-in. I mean, I take absolutely nothing for granted.
People have won on the write-in votes. Which is
and honestly, like the
has he said he was going to write in, or is that just
that's the rumor?
He's being pushed to do that.
That's the rumor I've heard. I haven't like James Sampson said. You know what I mean? I haven't, but I even a trickle down. And again, I say that in the weirdest ways because I really feel like that's all we have to work with, and we're always like up against it because we're trying to figure out what people are doing. Right now, right this very second, I am going to leave here and I'm going to go work with volunteers who are coming out in order to help get the word out about this campaign, because we just need a difference. We just
well,
need something.
Well, I want to say
different.
That I'm a manager. I came into Erie County in my 20s. I was made the senior budget examiner over 22 departments that were mainly headed by white Anglo-Saxon males. Who were professionals and in their 50s. And I had to gain their respect, gain their trust, show them that I had the training and the background to form a good plan for their department, to give them good recommendations, and we worked together to implement it. Now, we have a superintendent who has written an excellent plan for community schools to help our children be successful, to help the parents get the children to school, to give them wraparound services. Our superintendent has written an excellent plan for innovative public safety and service government administration high schools, for medical specialties high schools, for a computer academy. I am here to implement a plan for success, and woe be to anybody who doesn't want to work for putting these children first and for the success of our community.
Well,
because I think
because
we want
some
and Mary,
we want
Mary,
success.
And don't forget, he's talking to a lady who has spent 8 years in the military.
Right.
I don't think she'd be intimidated by Ms. Carpell, did anybody else
it's
on that board.
I command a battalion.
He is going to be there to make sure that all the things you said doesn't get done, believe you. Mm-hmm. I've talked to many of the present school board members. And they said,
excuse me, maybe he won't. He's got a challenger.
Isn't that
maybe
great?
Maybe he won't.
I was very pleased about that. 18 years old.
Yeah,
to
Austin Herod, 18 years old.
That would be something else if you upset
would
him.
That would be national news.
Senior Hutchinson Tech, and I was at the last debate they had, and he's sharp, he's compassionate, he's empathetic, he's very, very wise. I'm listening to him talking about diversity and how African-American students sometimes don't get their fair share because of the discriminatory practices by some people. If you close your eyes and listen to him talk, you think he's in his 20s or 30s.
Yeah,
very mature for 18 years old, and I just wish him all the luck.
I do, too. I think they're going to need all the help they can get. When I sat there and watched the last primary in New York when Paladino won, and here was this smiling Paladino standing behind Donald Trump. Yeah, you know, the Trump one. And I'm looking at him, and I'm saying, you know, why is he there? You know, why isn't something, what bothers me, I guess, is that all the good people.
My question was, why is the coach of the Buffalo Bills there? That was my biggest question.
He was there. Why was
introducing him?
Yeah, he needs to go. He's got to go.
He's there. What an insult.
Not mean to change the subject, but.
I'm totally with you with that.
He's got to go. Yeah, he's got to go. He's not. How can you form a team like that, you know?
Especially with the number of people of African American and other descent on that team.
Right.
Absolutely.
You know, and this man is there. And it was just to me.
See, he comes from that whole same ilk. The only reason he's a coach is because his father was a coach, Buddy Ryan. Mm-hmm. And wasn't with him, he would have never been in coaching. The same way with Donald Trump. They all come from people born on first, second, and third base, and don't nobody else to get up to the bat.
You got that silver spoon in your mouth. That's why we're here.
You know,
the first people who should have said that was those football players. Those players should have spoken out. So you know what? It's disrespectful to us as players
right, exactly.
and to the African American community that we come from to be supporting a man who has not condemned the KKK as much as he should.
Oh my,
it took him 2 days to do that. No,
and that is just, he's completely unqualified.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, it's like him picking a head coach who's never played football before.
Right.
You know, it just didn't make any sense. And I think
it was an insult and outrage, and they should have spoken on it.
There was we haven't talked about it. I want to ask our two ladies here, because they're going to be, it was in the Buffalo News, and I'm just wondering if they see this type of problem. It said, Buffalo schools tackle problem of teen pregnancy. Is that a problem in Buffalo schools?
It's
very
a problem.
So.
It's a problem in Buffalo. Mm-hmm. I mean, and they go to school, but yes.
I mean, is there like
yes.
a place for these young girls where they could maybe have a
Mary,
classroom
can I speak,
or
as a former
like
school
that?
Board member, when mm-hmm. I was a school board member, it was in 2000.
What, there used to be like a school or something?
They could not teach sex education in school. You know, they couldn't teach sex education. And so I think it's better now where they do can teach mm-hmm. health and teach sex education. And they can't teach preventive, and they can't, you know, talk.
And
about
they should
condoms.
Be teaching these young boys
but
too. It's responsibility.
Then they did a survey, and children as young as 12 years old having sex.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I think that if you're not teaching prevention at 12, and they already say they're having sex, well, 50% mm-hmm. of them say they're having sex, you have to have some kind of balance. So I think mm-hmm. that the teaching of preventive measures should be mm-hmm. instilled, because not only does teaching about condom prevent unwanted pregnancy, also stop or eliminate the risk of HIV mm-hmm. and other STDs mm-hmm. and AIDS. So I think
I'm a strong believer too that young men should be taught responsibility. You know, two people right. make babies, not just one.
Right.
And I don't think that we teach our young men enough about their responsibility in these relationships.
But sometimes a young lady has to be prepared too. And mm-hmm. if he doesn't have prevented materials, she should have some in her purse.
Right.
If she wants to engage in that.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that we teach about prevention and education. You're not telling people out there to do it. You're just saying here's the consequence if you do it, and
yeah.
here's some safety measure if you do. And I think that teaching about HIV and sexually transmitted disease is very needed in our Buffalo public schools, because the highest rate of HIV infection among women, senior citizen black women, and then the teenage male.
Yeah. We got a
people
man
come.
Here. What is your point? What do you believe in this about young men being taught responsibility, a different other thing? Do you hear it? Are you right? Because you're a bail bondsman,
too. I'm not a young man no more.
Well, I mean, but you're around, and you're in city court a lot. I mean, you must see a lot of these different things that come up to you.
Now, what is your question, Mary?
My question was, where do you stand
you
on
do
the idea of responsibility?
These young men know they're supposed to use, contraceptives, but sex is a natural, it was eating and sleeping, and when puberty is, I mean, it's a natural act. Now, I don't know, right, I don't know how you can curb it. I mean, my grandmother got married at 14, but she got married. So, I mean, this idea of young girls having babies is nothing new. I mean, it was just that people used to get married younger, you know. But you know, I really don't know the answer to the question.
You don't think we've been talking about responsibility and sex? I think from Betty Jean all the way down, that there's responsibility.
Well, I mean, it's a responsibility
things.
Not to kill each other either, but we kill each other every day. You know,
I think it's kind of lackadaisical.
I don't know. I don't know what the answer you want. I mean,
I guess the answer is that, as Betty Jean sort of alluded to,
there's condom commercials
sex
on TV.
You have to begin learning responsibility about engaging in sexual practice. I think the schools do have an obligation to start children learning about the responsibility.
Oh yeah, they had sex education in my high school, I think.
Mm-hmm.
They had sex education. I remember our gym teacher was our sex education teacher.
The gym teacher
still a lot of girls
got
pregnant, huh?
Mm-hmm. Gym teacher is always the health teacher.
Yeah, right, yeah. You mm-hmm. know. But that didn't stop the girls from my high school from getting pregnant, some of them, not all of them. In fact, probably less now then than now, I must say, come to think of it.
A lot of the children on my block are asking, why don't we teach life skills? Why isn't parenting taught in school? They used to have classes that prepared you for life. They don't teach these things in school anymore. Now that we have so many young children, 12-year-olds, 14-year-olds who've had children, mm-hmm. why aren't we having after-school programs to help these children, who are children themselves, and help them to get a high school diploma, mm-hmm. and help them to get skills? That's why we need to make our schools a center for the community.
But do you know there's technical reasons
programs.
Why that's not possible?
Well, you're talking about after school.
Because of the
thing.
Maintenance and the custodial contracts and stuff like that. It's easy to say those things, but once you get in there, you realize it's a lot more complicated than keeping to keep the schools open all night. A lot
more
complicated.
Is there a lot of union objection to
that? Well, there's engineering contracts that's been handed out for 100 years that you got to have somebody in that building. And if you're not willing to pay them,
you can't open the schools.
Then you can't open the schools. That's what I'm saying. And people have been saying that, why don't we keep the schools open for years and years? But when you actually come down to it, it's not possible.
When I came to the Erie County Youth Department, they didn't have a early intervention program for 3 and 4 year olds either. And guess what? There is one now. Legislation and funding and creativity and a demand for a service will make it happen.
Okay.
I think when you have the demand,
intend to make a difference.
Okay.
When you have the demand and you start asking the questions why, my mind immediately comes to the reason why I'm trying and why I'm doing this is you know what you need. Everything is there. We know what we need, but why hasn't it been there? So let's look into what's in place now and have that all the way down the line. What type of education is out there on this level in health now? Compare what's been in the past and bring it to, you know, what can we do? But we don't sit and think about that. We keep trying to, and it's the way in everyday life. But on the board, when we're talking about our kids, if we don't bring it back to the very beginning and start looking at how we can change things to right now and meet people where they're at, we're in trouble. Keep trying to settle things with dollars that not, I don't have dollars. I can't build a charter school and make that happen or whatever it is Palladino and them are doing. I want to be able to look at what Buffalo schools offer and fix it and figure out what we can do to make it better.
Point. If you've got to worry about engineers who are worrying about their contracts and they're saying that you've got to keep a custodian in here and that's a union situation, for Paulette, how would you keep that school open for after school classes if you've got to get around the engineers?
Well, see, I've been asked the question about the good and bad parts of receivership. Mm-hmm. One of the good parts of receivership is it can void all contracts. And people who don't want to negotiate for the best interests of the children, that is the big stick that says, do you want a job at all? Because all contracts can be voided under the receivership. Now,
I think
we need to look realistically at where we can put our monies to benefit these children, how we can have extended school year, extended school days, and how we can change this failing system into something that's a world-class education system.
What about year-round schooling? That's one of the things my things with teachers unions that they say all this, but they get the summers off, which most people don't.
There's no reason why these kids
can middle early
school
college is
year
year-round schooling, and that's a Buffalo public school.
Yeah. Right. I also want to say too that when I was on the board, we didn't have receivership; we had what's called negotiation. So I'm sure that if community after-school program is wanted by the community and parents express their need, and maybe that could be one of the negotiated items when they start. Negotiated contract. And I'm sure that teacher union would be amenable to certain negotiations, some concession, and I know that they talk about many more community schools. And community school open, I remember School 53 does open on Saturday for parents' breakfast. I remember being open in the afternoon. So there's something that can be negotiated through the union, but it has to be asked by the parents and by the community. So I'm
we're
sure
down on our last 2 minutes, and I want to give this to our candidates.
Okay.
And so give them an opportunity to talk to voters out there. You're talking to a lot of voters right now. What would you like to say? We started, I think, with you last time, so we'll start with you this time, Jennifer. And we're working on about a minute for each of you.
Okay, for me, I think that I would really like for voters to look at bringing themselves to the table. If you don't come in big numbers out to start talking about what it is that you need and what it is that, you know, if elected, I can represent for you on that seat. I'm there not as Jen for Jen. I'm there for you all. I need for you guys to vote for someone who will take your concerns right to the table, find out the questions that you have, find those answers for you, and work with a good group of folks, a good group of folks that's going to end up on this board that is going to change things, because we're going to have voices from all over this city and not just one district, not just a pocket.
Oh, okay.
For me,
I'm concerned
with
keeping our children in school, increasing student achievement, reducing suspensions, and making sure that after 12 years, every one of our children come out with a job, a skill, a career, employable, able to be a productive citizen. Help me to help your child succeed. Let them be the future for our city that we deserve. We want a world-class system, educational system. I want to put your tax dollars to use efficiently. With your help, we can make a difference in the Buffalo schools. Vote 1A, Paulette Woods, May 3rd.
What is your line?
Vote
1A. Okay, thank you.
So you're 1A?
Yeah, 1A.
Okay, so we know that there are lines. I'm your host, Mary Davis, and you all know Betty Jean Grants. We don't have to reintroduce her. You all know Frank Gifts from being
on
the
show. Vote May 3rd.
Vote May 3rd.
And
vote for these two wonderful people who are running for the Board of Education, and we need them there. Again, I'm your host, Mary Davis. Stay with the station, and you can catch this show again on the web. It is on the web. Just go to themarydavisshow.com, and you'll see them again on the web. Have a very good evening. Thank you.